Stretch forth your hand toward our bishop. These are marvelous words, words that bring healing. It's amazing how a single right person can wipe away the influence of 1,000 wrong people in your life. Thank God. Thank God. Father, I thank you for the grace that's upon a precious man of God that we admire, we value. Tonight we release the new season in his life. Let these books go around the world. They contain life-changing golden keys. Golden keys. Lord, it's been your anointing upon him that has opened the doors, kept the doors open, and his voice will be heard around the earth. Thank you for it. Father, all across the world where there's churches that need this, let the bookstores, let the pastors, let the leaders of the earth receive this revelation that you put inside of him. And this incredible book by his wife that contains secrets, Lord, I've seen them. You have given her revelation. You have given her wisdom and insight. And just like he has freely received what you have offered, let him find receivers everywhere. In Jesus' name, it is done. Praise God. Oh, it is done. And I tell you, these are not just books. Let me tell you, they contain life-giving. They're life-giving. They're really life-giving. And some of these were printed on the World Printing Press, weren't they? Weren't some of these printed on the World? Give the Lord a hand clap. Some of these were printed on the World Printing Press. Give God a big hand clap. This is fabulous. This is wonderful. Praise God. Thank you, man of God. And it's my joy. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. And tomorrow, you're preaching at the Wisdom Center. And I hope you... I'll let God talk to you about which one of these books, but I have a couple of favorite there. Amen. Thank you from my heart. Hold your Bible close to your heart. Stroke it like you would stroke the cheek of a child. I love sitting at your feet. Now kiss your Bible. I love hearing what you say. Now just rub it over your face. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. All my nights away, I love sitting at your feet every single day. Yes, yes, everybody, like a choir. I love sitting at your feet every single day. The Bible says a man that doesn't sin with his mouth is not a sinner at all. That if a man understands the power of his words, if a man doesn't sin with his mouth, he doesn't sin. Powerful, isn't it? That if a man can keep his words right, nothing will happen adversely in his life. That the tongue is like the rudder of a ship that decides where it lands. My words create my lifestyle. My words create my experiences. My mouth controls my daily events of my life. Death and life. death and life are in the power of the tongue. He that loveth it shall eat the fruit thereof. Stroke your Bible again. Now kiss it. Rub it over your face. Say, this is my wisdom. Say it again. This is my wisdom. You sitting there in Brazil watching, we've already got tweets from you that you're watching and all over the world. Wherever you are, get ready for the happiest night, because the next few minutes are going to be transforming. They really are transforming. You'll never go back. How many's already used up yesterday anyway? How many's ready to birth a new future? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just say these words, my mouth. And I hope we keep the words you said too, my brother. That so blessed me. Made me feel a little old to know that all you were children at that time. But it's, I tell you, your words are creating your life. Your words are creating your life. Your words are creating your life. Praise God. I always have people to talk to each other next to each other, because most of them don't know what to say to one another. So we teach people what to say. So tell somebody next to you, say, your only problem is your ignorance. Just turn to somebody and say, your only problem is your ignorance. You may be seated. Praise God. Ushers, would you give everybody a special copy of the book, Seven Decisions? Take out a pen. I want you to write 10 things inside this book. So if you will. Pastor James asked me to focus on some of the revelation God had given me about wisdom for wealth. And I love that subject because it's so seldom referenced in the ministry. If you do not have this book, Seven Decisions, lift your hand high. They'll come right to you. And ushers, if you'll put a bundle at the beginning of each row and let the people give them out, that'll help. Who does not have a copy of this book yet? You do not have a copy? All right, I guess we've already given it out then. Good. I do want to mention, can you bring me those two gifts there? Yes. Those that have been planting, and there is something electrifying about the $1,000 seed. We had a pastor and his wife in New York got up at our meetings recently there. Had about 300 partners and shared how they had watched me on television. She said, did you hear what Mike just said? He broke the back of poverty with a $1,000 seed. He said, we don't even have $1,000. She said, then we'll borrow it. 30 days later, after their $1,000 seed, their church received a donation of $100 million. $100 million. I love to share that illustration because I look across the audience and I see the jealous spirit on which certain people. So I can sort of differentiate between the Davids and the King Saul spirit. Jealous. But it's true. It's true. My seed controls my future. I can create any future I want with my seed. Something in my hand can create anything I want in my future. I'm a walking seed factory. Everything in me is a seed. I'm a seed. When I enter any environment, the harvest begins. Hallelujah. Not only are we seeds, but we're somebody's walking harvest. Just say it out loud. I'm the best thing that'll happen to somebody today. Now say it again. I'm the best thing that'll happen to somebody today. Say these words. Just say them aloud. Everywhere I go, I happen. And everywhere I happen becomes a fun place. Hallelujah. 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 I think every church ought to have across the front of it, joy happens here. Just say these words, joy happens here. Say it again, joy happens here. Praise God. Praise God. Those who plant $1,000 seed into the Wisdom Center, I work for the Lord and what we're doing for God, be sure and go by the table because I have three wonderful gifts for you. Three wonderful gifts. We have the Wisdom Bible, which contains 160 pages of all my personal notes over the years. The 46 Secrets of Abigail, Esther, Solomon, Paul, David, Abraham, All of that is in here. Plus, you'll receive the 12 hours of teaching that I did live at the Wisdom Center called the Millionaire 300. Over 100 wealth secrets. We talk about the one thing Donald Trump. The one thing that Donald Trump puts in every contract that's made his family a fortune, and it's in nobody's contract. We add that here. So many, there's wealth secrets. Those who have what you don't have know something you don't know. God never told us that the devil could really, really mess us up. He said, your ignorance has made you messed up. The only weapon that Satan has is your ignorance. So all of that is in these tapes. Also the CDs. You'll also get the Wisdom World Reader. It contains over 100 of my books, The Law of Recognition, and it'll hold over 2,000 books. All three of those, this is not normal. As you know, Brother Uri, so you'll have to make this special. This is not normal, but I called today and I said, I want to give all three of these gifts to anyone who plants a $1,000 seed. Your $1,000 reaches a million homes with the gospel. A million homes with the gospel. Turn to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4. If you don't have a Bible, we'll sell you one. We've got many. Proverbs chapter 4. I love Nairobi. I've spent a total of about a year in Kenya and Tanzania and learned to fall in love with that place and the people of Nairobi. And we're thankful, so thankful for this opportunity to be here. And I love the singing that happened up here. I tell you, if you weren't happy when you came in, you're happy now when you listen to the anointing that's on that. Tonight, my focus is going to be on this, and I want to talk to you tonight about the eagle, what I call the Eagle 10 life. The Eagle 10 life. In the 10th chapter of Mark, Jesus told Peter, whatever cost anything you invest in me while I'm here, anything you invest in the kingdom has a return of 100-fold on it. Now, 100-fold in the original means maximum yield. It really doesn't mean 100 times. We say that because that's the way we can imagine. But he said, anything you give up for me, any investment that you made, and remember that in the eagle's life, we're talking about really prosperous life of an eagle. Eagles do not attend barnyard conferences. Eagles are not excited by chicken conversation. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount upon wings as eagles. Say, I'm an eagle. So I'm going to give you part of an Eagle 10 lifestyle, because God doesn't decide your success. He desires it, designs it, you decide it. My success is not a divine decision. My success is my decision. My success is a daily experience. Success is an experience, not a destination. Success is an experience. I'm going to walk you through some definitions tonight. It's going to be concentrated. It's going to be enriching. And I want you to become a receiver of divine knowledge, divine insight. Proverbs 4, verse 7. Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. Now, that means if you get it, you're not born with it. You're born with instincts, not wisdom. That's why you can have 5 kids and 2 are idiots. And 3 are obedient. Wisdom doesn't come through the bloodline. You can have a horrible father like Saul and become a Jonathan. You can be a brilliant man like David and give birth to a guy like an Absalom. genes do not control your wisdom. He said, get it. With all thy getting, get understanding. Exalt her, she shall promote thee. She shall promote thee. Not a man. Wisdom decides position. Wisdom decides your salary. Your wisdom decides your honor. Exalt her. She shall bring thee to honor when thou dost embrace her. She shall give to thine head an armor of grace, a crown of glory shall she deliver to thee. Verse 11, I have taught thee in the way of wisdom. Verse 12, when thou goest, thy steps shall not be straitened, and when thou runnest, thou shalt not stumble. 13, take fast hold of instruction. Let her not go. Keep her, for she is thy life. An instruction is an invitation to intimacy. An instruction is an opportunity to prove your trust. Every failure can be traced to an ignored instruction. Every failure is created through an ignored instruction. An instruction reveals everything about you. I know your future if I see your reaction to an instruction. Lady came to him and said, I want a job at the Wisdom Center. I said, well, see our manager? She's right over there. I want to give it to you. I don't want to give it to her. I said, now you know I'm not going to hire you. I gave you the first instruction. I hadn't even hired you. Now, if this is your best at impressing me, you've lost already. She's still not working at the Wisdom Center. Why? She can't follow a cotton picking instruction. Now, she can't follow a cotton picking instruction. You know she can't follow a divine instruction. I'm going to walk you through some definitions, then I'm going to give you some keys. Because wealth is not a divine decision. It's a divine provision. If God decided who had money, why are missionaries broke and the mafia is wealthy? God get addresses mixed up? The gospel has two parts, and this is fundamental to us. The person of Jesus and the principles that he taught. The person of Jesus creates my peace. His principles create my prosperity. The life of God creates my joy. The laws of God decides the flow of my money. Well, Mike, I serve God. Why don't I have any money? Because serving God has nothing to do with money. You should know that by now. Well, I'm really praying. Have you ever known of a rich intercessor? Intercessors are usually the most broke ones in the church. They're the ones you have to pick up the tab for their apartment. The person of Jesus makes me ready for eternity. The principles that he taught makes me ready for earth. I don't have to do anything to get loved by God, but I have to do something to get blessed by God. So Psalms 112, he says, a man that loves the cross, no. A man that loves the blood, no. A man that's been in the upper room, wealth and riches will be in his house, no. Most tongue talkers are broke. A man that loves the statutes, the laws, the commandments of God, wealth and riches would be in his house. What bothered me my whole lifetime was that my father, who I've just been with this afternoon, we had a little Christmas lunch together over at my brother David's house. My father is a man of prayer. He's a holy man. He's a righteous man. The worst thing he's ever done is murder little ducks. He loved to shoot ducks out of the air, explode them to pieces with a 12-gauge shotgun. That's the worst thing he's ever done. A holy man, a righteous man. But when I wanted to go to Bible school, My father did not have $4 a day to pay my way through Bible school. That bothered me, Dr. Craig. That bothered me. Wait. My father loves God so much that he doesn't do anything wrong. I mean, no cussing, no drinking, no fornication, no liquor, no gambling, nothing. And doesn't have $4 a day to put his son through Bible school? My God can heal cancer. My God can get you out of a wheelchair. But he has no money. So over the years, I begin to contest that. What's wrong? God doesn't like enough to give money. He doesn't love God enough to get any money. So we're all kind of broke around here. And I begin to look into the Word of God, and I begin to see laws. The laws that if I honored that law would produce a reward. If I broke a law, it created a consequence. If you break a law, you give up a reward. The purpose of laws on the earth are to create order, the accurate arrangement of things. The accurate arrangement of things. Order means the accurate arrangement of things. Say that with me. The accurate arrangement of things. Say it again. If my nose was on top of my head, I would drown the first rain. What if my eyes were on the bottom of my feet? Who's coming? I don't know. Let me see who's coming. Oh, my eyes hurt. I just stepped on a rock. Order is the accurate arrangement of things. And the purpose of instructions is to create order in your life. The stop sign is a law to keep order and keep you in your lane where you belong. Did that bother you? You couldn't hardly concentrate, could you? But it fits, doesn't it? Doesn't it fit? But it doesn't belong there. This is a stylus to write on my computer with. My watch has a place it belongs. So when God begins to teach us laws, it's how to increase scripturally and legally in his world, in his environment. The Bible is a book about decisions. The most difficult thing I've had to get across to the body of Christ is something everybody believes but me. And I have a conference, I go, God's in control. God's in control. Now, there is nothing more satisfying to a human than the belief that God controls everything. Because now it removes my guilt for bad things happening. God has a reason. If God's in control of everything, then explain rape. God was in control. I was going through England a few weeks ago, and me and the customs official, he was sitting there looking through my passport and stuff, and he looked at me and says, what are you here for? I said, conference. He said, what are you going to teach? I said, how to achieve your dream. He went, ha, God's in control of that. And he cocked his head and looked at me and said, you believe that? I said, of course not. It's ludicrous. He said, I believe it. I said, you're dead wrong. Well, that kind of stopped my process. The ignorant struggle for power because they have nothing else. He said, you don't believe that God controls everything? I said, you have a daughter? Yeah. I said, what if she's raped? He said, God had a rape. I said, oh, so you have no repercussions about a man raping your daughter. That's okay. That was God. That was God. I said, boy, you have a stupid God. I said, I wouldn't even bow to a God like that. I said, how could you be so stupid as to embrace a God who would rape your daughter. It's okay to have a powerless God, but you don't want a God who's mean. You already have a devil. Why would you worship a devil for a God? So he kept explaining, and I kept saying, so you don't believe our decision? No, and he began his little tirade of stuff, and I just looked at him, and I started, of course, I have a passion to persuade. The weakness is I can sometimes get connected to a fool, and I waste my energy. I said, so if somebody murders your boy, that's okay with you? That was in God's will. God took him home. God needed a little flower in heaven. Think of God so desperate that he uses a dead child for a flower. Look at someone next to you and say, doesn't your ignorance concern you? Just look at him right now and say, doesn't your ignorance concern you? The Bible's a book about decisions. Let me explain. If God's in control of everything, then why do we need teachers? Isaiah 1:17 says, learn to do well. Didn't say believe. Said learn. Didn't say fast. Didn't even say pray to do well. Learn. Learn. Learn to do well. To do well, learn. There are seven decisions that if you make these decisions, some of you have heard my testimony, how that I had a problem with my blood pressure, and the doctor sent me on a 26-hour drive home from Canada, and it was a very difficult place, very difficult place. Over 30 washcloths filled up with blood, 2 hours to stop the blood from dripping through my nose from the plane. Dwight Thompson and his wife Zonelle flew to my home, and she said, Mike, you've got to stop everything. I said, I can't. I've got a $4 million budget. I've got television every week. I've got a staff. It has to have payroll, and I can't. She said, you must remember my father, and I did, Bracy Greer. I remembered him. Husky man, forgot his blood pressure medicine home, went to a conference, and while preaching, had a stroke. Was reduced to a wheelchair for 9 years and couldn't speak. Saliva dripping down his mouth for 9 years. Husky, man of God, a man of prayer. Remember, God's not responsible for my health. I'm responsible for my health. He's responsible for healing. I'm responsible for my health. I'm thinking of many things. Some worthy and some not. I prayed 9 to 1 o'clock every day, 4 hours a day, and a few weeks for 4 months. Never left my house but 5 times for 4 months. At the end of 4 months, I had more money in all of my accounts I'd ever had in the history of my life. Never received one offering. Never flew to one meeting. Because of 3 words God spoke to me one morning. Decisions decide wealth. Decisions decide wealth. Christians have the illusion God will decide your wealth. No, God's the source of your wealth. It's not a divine decision. God's the source of your wealth. I knew that hard work didn't make people prosperous. The hardest working people I know are the lowest paid. I knew that prayer didn't decide wealth because nobody had ever attended my father's prayer meetings ever had any. Decisions decide wealth, and God gave me 107 to write down. And I wrote down as fast as I could, and he just gave me one after another. One of the 107 was my decision to ignore human flaws, to find the gold God had hidden in them. Because everything you want is in somebody you don't like. Something you need is hidden in someone you don't enjoy. Packaging is deceptive. That's why cereal's not in a see-through package. God so blessed me, and I watched the hand of God upon my life, and everything I touched just seemed to prosper. It was just miraculous. And I knew I had tapped into something. So I have printed this book by the tens of thousands around the world. We just taught 16,000 people in Brazil about 4 months ago. Just came back from there last week or sometime, maybe this week, sometime. But I want you to see these seven decisions. Just say this out loud. My decisions have decided my financial life. Say it again. My decisions have decided my financial life. Now, if you've heard me teaching on church by phone at 7 o'clock at night, every night, 7 o'clock Texas time, I teach for 1 hour on the phone. People from all over the world listen. And one of the things I share, why men stay poor, because poverty is a personal decision. Poverty is a decision to ignore the divine deposits hidden in you. Poverty is a decision to ignore those who have achieved what you have not. Let's review these seven decisions. Are you ready? Number one, let's read it aloud. Your decision to build your faith. One more time. Your decision to build your faith. Number two, your decision to excel in your present assignment. Again, your decision to excel in your present assignment. Three, your decision to honor the scriptural chain of authority. Again, your decision to honor the scriptural chain of authority. Remember, money comes down, it doesn't flow up. The only person God can use to bless you financially is someone in authority. It's not Isaac to Abraham, it's Abraham to Isaac. Four, your decision to pursue an uncommon mentor. Again, your decision to pursue an uncommon mentor. Five, your decision to look for divine rewards in every battle. Again, your decision to look for divine rewards in every battle. Everywhere there's an enemy, there's a palace. When you see Goliath, you realize that your pasture days are coming to a close. God's getting you ready for the palace. Hallelujah. Six, your decision to continuously listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Again, your decision to continuously listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit. Remember, He talks more than anybody you've met. He talks through His word. He talks through your conscience. He talks through authority. He talks through opportunity. God never told David to fight Goliath. It was simply an opportunity to generate a reward. God talks through favor. Never do business with somebody that has no favor towards you. In other words, stay where you're liked. Tonight I finished up a series called If You Were My Daughter. The big headline is What Fathers Wish Daughters Knew. What fathers wish daughters knew. And I have many spiritual daughters throughout the world, and they're always asking me for counsel and advice. And so I have a series, we have 10 hours on it, If You Were My Daughter. One of the things Naomi told Ruth, this man Boaz likes you, so stay where he can keep looking at you. Excellence craves scrutiny. Seven, Your decision to sow seed with expectation of a specific harvest. Again, your decision to sow seed with expectation of a specific harvest. Everybody sows. Even nothing's a seed. Nobody is stopping you from sowing. Nobody. You sow every day of your life. You sow something or you sow nothing. But sowing with expectation decides the future of that seed. Let's go back again. Number one, out loud, everybody. Your decision to build your faith. What is faith? Confidence in God. Why is faith so important? It's the only time God has ecstasy. Without faith, it is impossible to pleasure God. God's only passion is to be trusted. So he created a universe of gift displays. Now you get to look at everything for free. But the size of your faith decides what happens to the gifts. $10 faith will produce a $10 gift from the display. You work with your faith because your faith is deciding the favor of God toward you. It took me a long time to realize God doesn't react to my pain. He feels it, but he doesn't react to it. Remember the woman who had hemorrhaged for a dozen years? She's crawling through the crowd, said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I know I'll be made whole. She was not on Jesus' agenda. Why didn't Jesus just stop and say, oh, bless you. I know about that report. I saw the doctor's report. Bless you. You don't have to crawl through this crowd. Just she falls. No. God doesn't react to your pain. God doesn't react to your poverty. God does not react. God has a price on everything he does. Now, I'm going to throw this because this is kind of a chosen group tonight. This is not your normal ignoramus crowd, okay? I want to say something. Everything is bought. Calvary was currency that bought us. Everything is purchased. Only the price changes. God really corrected me. One night I was telling everybody, I said, you can't buy a miracle. And everybody, yeah. And God, the Holy Spirit just spoke to me and said, who told you that? Wait. Now, I'm thinking of the guy, the sorcerer, you know, who told Peter, let me give you some money and so I can just have this tongue part on everybody. And Peter said, your money perish with you. Think you can buy the things of God with money. And the Holy Spirit stopped me and said, everything has a price. The price of Naaman's healing of leprosy was dipping in Jordan 7 times. That's his price. Every gift on the universal display, every gift, there's 58 kinds of blessings. Every one of them, God said, you can choose and work with your faith. You can use a little faith, use great faith, no faith. Faith creates pleasure with God. Now, who do you want to feel good? Somebody who can bless you. Even the hostess at a restaurant knows that if you put your hand on the shoulder of a customer, while you're taking their order, your tip jumps 10 to 20%. See, I consider being a waitress. Now, when you study these things, that's a joke. When you study these things, you want to get along with somebody who writes you checks. That's why not only is a tither untrusting, a non-tither doesn't trust God, but he's kind of next to stupid. That somebody who could be so good to him, he treats so bad. I got to work with my faith. How do I work with my faith? Don Rattery, I talked about you today, Don. I was taking some vitamins. Don has a real, real fabulous understanding of vitamins. He's got more energy than any 20-year-old you've met. And he's 70, 73. And he's been everywhere with me. He's traveled many miles with me. And I tell you, between him and Brother Davis dancing, MTV is out of business if you watch these two. But I was taking, because he really has a knowledge of vitamins. You take these vitamins. Now, when I take the swatter of the vitamins, do I go, whoo, no. Actually, I feel nothing. Because they have a little system in the capsules, time release. Which means as you take these, over time, it begins to nourish parts of you. And finally, you begin. That's the way the words of God. You don't quote the scripture, for God so loved the world. Ooh, oh, my Lord, the money's falling out of my pockets. No. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. So God's words contain faith. That's miraculous. Not really. I went to Brookstone. And the girl showed me a $129 pillow, $129 if I remember. And I said to her, now what fool would come in here and buy a pillow for $129? She looks at me and says, I felt the same way. I thought that was ridiculous when I came to work here. And I decided I would just try it. She said, I could not believe the difference in my sleep. She said, in fact, I bought one for every member of my family. Family, I walked out of there with pillows for my whole family. $8,000 worth of mattresses. Now, she wasn't God, but her words. And her sincerity. Whew, I just believed her. God said, if you just believe me, if you just believe me, you can talk to anything and it'll submit to your authority. Talk to a mountain. I've tried it so far, I hadn't got that kind of faith. But I did try walking on the water in the bathtub when I was like 9 and 10, 11 years old. Say, my faith creates my lifestyle. My faith creates my lifestyle. Say it again. My faith. Say it again. My faith. Now, God's asking us to have faith in him. He didn't say have faith in people. He said your faith. Now, men that don't even serve God have faith in those laws. That's why they produce. Genesis, when he said, even these people, they're about to build a tower. He said, the thing they've imagined, they can do. This was mind power. And it's a divine law. It's a divine law. It's a divine law. Mind power. Oh, I don't get into the mind. Well, you need one to get into it. But he has given you one. Just tap your head and say, I have the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Now, unity has more power than truth. Now, that's kind of obvious, isn't it? Hitler, they had unity. They didn't have the truth. They didn't have truth. What do you think terrorism has worked? They all have God? No. They have unity. Two evil men can create more havoc on the earth than 1,000 Christians not united. Unity has more power than truth. So God said, if you'll get into agreement with me. Today I was praying for somebody related to me on the phone with my sister Deborah. We were just really intense. Matthew 8, I said, sis, this agreement thing can work. We are in an agreement. God said, if I can find two people who agree with something I want, nothing will be denied them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Number two, your decision to excel in your present assignment. There are seven systems that are important in succeeding in your assignment. Let me drop this picture because it's powerful. Everything created on the earth solves a problem on the earth. Not just the food chain. My ears hear, my eyes see, my mouth speaks, my mind thinks, my hands reach. Your assignment is a problem God has given you to solve for a person or a group of people. Everywhere there's a problem, there's a future. Everywhere there's a problem, the potential for favor is there. It is ludicrous to say, I can't find a job. What you're saying is, I see no problems on the earth I'm designed to solve. Well, then leave here. Until somebody has a problem, you're unnecessary. Until somebody has a problem, you have no reward system. Because the reward system is built around a problem. Why Bill Gates, he got up to $87 billion. He solved problems. Little problem, little salary. Big problem, big salary. If you can solve, if you can answer the phone, you get X amount of dollars. If you answer it cheerfully, you get a little more. If you process the phone call properly, a little more. If you can enter the information in a computer, now you get a little bit more. That's why every time, everywhere you see a problem, God has given you a key to a reward system. A world without problems is a world you're unnecessary. Brother Mike, I don't know. I'm waiting for my assignment. I just waiting for. I had a lady one time worked at the Wisdom Center, and this is her complaint. She said, I feel like I'm by Joseph in the prison. I'm waiting. I said, you feel like the Wisdom Center is a prison for you? Yep. I just got ahead. I said, I'm going to free you today. We're going to free you. We're going to get you out of this prison, and we're going to bring you a little check to carry out with you. What an ignoramus. Joseph solved problems where he was. You need an information system? Where do you collect data? Number two, you need a task management system. Three, you need an inspirational system, how to inspire yourself. Because if you can keep yourself inspired, there's nothing you cannot do. Your only struggle in life is to stay inspired. That's it. If I can keep inspired. So you go through your house and you take off the walls pictures that don't excite you. The nephew that was disrespectful to you, take his picture off the wall. Your father-in-law who won't give you any help, take his picture off the wall. Put pictures in front of you of people who inspire you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you can keep yourself inspired, nobody can stop you. Keep in front of you what you want in you. Now, how do you excel in your present assignment? I've said this 1,000 times. Your future depends on who likes you. Your future depends on who likes you. I cannot change your life till I change who likes you. I use this illustration because it's needed repeatedly. I have three assistants. I'm sitting there and I make the statement, I sure would love some carrot juice. Assistant number one said, me too, Dr. Murdock. I love carrot juice. I didn't know you liked carrot juice. Me too. And he stands there. Assistant number two says, well, Dr. Murdock, if I had some carrots, I'd make you some. Brain level number two. Assistant number three. He likes carrot juice. I'll be right back, Dr. Murdock. And back comes some carrot juice. Would you like it twice a day, three times a day? Now, if number three wants to go further, he can say he obviously wants it daily, so he'll never have to ask again. Because if your boss has to give you the same instruction twice, we will half your little salary. You have a secretary, pastor? If you have to tell her something twice, half her salary. If you have to tell her something four times, she's a child, bring her over to child care center and give her some toys and dolls. I can tell you in 5 seconds who cares about my pain. You don't need but one quality to succeed wildly on the earth. That's just care. If you just care, you will not meet in your lifetime. I say this, I'll be 70 years old in a few weeks. You will not meet 5 people out of 1,000 who care. But when you do, grab them, hold them, keep them close. And I wouldn't enter into a training program to try to teach somebody to care. Why? Because I don't feel like we're Methuselah. I don't think we have those many years. And I feel like teaching cats to bark is a tormenting goal. Didn't I tweet something or text you today? I text you today about that, just finding someone who cared. Now everybody go, is the answer of somebody who can't wait for you to leave their presence. If I say to Julie, I'm very concerned about such and such. Me too, Dr. Murdock. We all have problems, Dr. Mike. We all have problems. I won't say, God gave you a sister for you. Do you want to excel where you are? Today is the seed for tomorrow. You had a chance today to impress somebody. Who am I supposed to impress? Who's got the problem? Duh. Was it Fox News last night where they said, the shooter has a mental disorder. Duh. Oh, wow. Whoa, what a job that was to assess that. When you open your mouth, you reveal your IQ. Who should you impress? Carlos? If I call you and say, son, I need some videos.
with some lower thirds really finished quick. And Carlos says to me, Dr. Mark, you know, I sure love you, man. I wish you could. You know, tonight I got a date. And how old are you, son? 21. Dr. Mark, I'm 21. I've waited two decades to find a woman, and I think found her. And Dr. Murdock, I really don't have the energy. I don't have the time. Doctor, I wish I could. I tell you, next week would be better for me. I'm saying, Carlos, may God give you the desire of your heart. And may she be so ugly you forget how to work. He had an opportunity because I had a problem. Gabriella sitting on the back seat like an unspiritual woman. It's all right. Lois is spiritual. So I say to you, you know how much I love greeting cards, right? Right? You can say, you can nod. You're not on camera. It's over here. She's a phenomenal artist. Phenomenal. So I say, Miss Gabriella, if you would, I've got some wisdom keys that I want to put on greeting cards. Well, Dr. Warnock, you know, I'm going to school right now. You know, I got to go to college. You know, I don't work 20 hours a week now. Is that right? 20 hours a week. Am I correct? See, I wish you could. I told her about a problem I had. Oh, brother Mike, I can give you an hour. I'll give you an hour next week. I said, it's all right. Keep your hour. Pastor Monica, I really need help. My library is in disorder. I've got so many electronics I've got to put in order. Would you help me? Dr. Murdock, I've been with you 19 years. You know I would do anything, but right now, I'm going to Guatemala for vacation. I say, well, come by the office. We're going to have a going away party, and we'll see you sometime in the years ahead. I'm sure our paths will cross. Everybody who makes my life harder is an adversary to my dream. If you make my life harder, you are an adversary to my dream, my goals. So what do I do? If I want to excel where I am, I must study the countenance of those around me, like Joseph did. Joseph didn't look at the butler and the baker and said, you're upset because the king's mad at you, but how would you like for a woman to lie about you? I've been here in the prison 2 years because a woman lied about me. Not Joseph. Now, if that had been me in the prison, I'd already written 12 books. 12 women you must avoid in your lifetime. I would have had a powerful book, a series of books. But Joseph, the Bible said he remembered. He remembered. He remembered his dream. His dream. His dream. Nobody that solves problems loses a job. Problem solvers lose their job. You want to make my life hard? No problem. But I won't keep you on payroll. I promise you. Now, Miss Estella wouldn't fire the devil. She could have 50 Judases and she'd just say, I believe in God to change them. But I don't have that kind of feeling because the money's out of my pocket. She'd feel a little different if she was giving her money to the payroll, wouldn't you? A little different. But when you make my life hard, well, do you excel where you are? Would I feel good being around you? Are you a good experience for me? Are you a painful experience for me? Do you increase my load or do you remove my load? Do you hear me when I talk? Do you ignore me when I talk? Had a precious man, he's a good man, very good man, was with me on a trip some time ago. And we just landed somewhere, New York, I think it was, yeah. And so he's looking at his cell phone. I said, "Brother, have you called Brother Marquez, who was in a hotel there? Have you called him?" And is he? And he went, mm-hmm. And I said something else. He said, mm-hmm. And he's looking, mm-hmm. And I grabbed him. I said, "Don't you mm-hmm me like I'm your child. I just asked you a question. What did I just say?" He didn't even know what I said. And he's a good man. He's a very good man. But he wouldn't listen to me. I don't like that. It's getting so quiet in here. Maybe we should take communion right now. If you were my daughter, I'd tell you, don't marry a man who won't talk. He's talking to somebody else if he won't talk to you. It's normal to talk. And I want my words heard. Here's some keys in excelling at work. Know who your boss is. Know what he likes and what he hates. Know his friends and who he's uncomfortable with. Identify what makes him uncomfortable in any environment. Please him or her. Make him happy. You wanted this by tomorrow at 12 o'clock? It'll be there. Don't take the side of somebody else against the one who's writing you the check. I had a nephew one time that worked for me. And I said, "Son, I want this out in, I think it was 7 days or two. This is a teaching, a CD that God's put in my heart. And I want this out in the next 7 days." It may have been 2 weeks, but like 7 days. And he said, "Uncle Mike, that company has other customers too. You can't just expect them to drop everything they're doing and do your CD and duplicate it." I said, "Oh, son, I had no idea you were working for them. I've been writing you a check all these months thinking you were working for me." I said, "Have you called them out? I just told you." "No, but I know them and they got work to do." I said, "And you're trying now to get them what they want, and I'm the guy writing you the check." It's like buying your wife jewelry and she goes to bed with somebody else. I got on the phone. The guy said, "Dr. Murdock, we'll be thrilled. We'll have it there in 4 days for you." Duh. I'm going to use this little illustration because I think you might grasp it. Don't that sound condescension? That's to provoke you. I'm going to use this illustration. It's powerful. If you can develop an excellence in problem solving, you will never be without favor the rest of your days. Never. If you can excel in your present environment, where you are is an opportunity to become. An opportunity to become. You got 2 more minutes? Okay. Everybody can leave, just me and Roxanne here, I guess. Number 7, your decision to sow seed with expectation. Now, everybody thinks of money as seed. I don't. I think of every word as a seed. I think of myself as a seed. I'm a walking factory. Put number 7 on the board there. I'm a walking factory of seeds. My time is a seed. I'm investing a piece of me every day. Every day. I sow caution here. I show love here. I show encouragement here. I am sowing every hour of my life. God has given me a stash of things to sow. A stash of things to sow. My information is a seed. I sat down with a man of God in Brazil. He had 7,000 partners. And I said, let me share with you. He couldn't pay for 30 minutes of TV a week. 7,000 partners and couldn't buy a half hour on TV a week. And I said, let me tell you what God has shown me. And I'm going to share. And he sat there and took notes. Today, he has 250,000 partners. Amen. He's on television 7 hours a day. Wow. His stadium meetings run 300,000. God, through a seed he planted of 8,500, gave him a jet, Gulfstream. He's flown me all over Brazil. Flew me all the way back to my house in Dallas, all the way from Rio de Janeiro. Most gorgeous plane you've ever seen, holds 19 people. And his two pilots flew me all the way back. And I said, oh, brother, that costs too much. Just let me buy a little plane ticket. Don't. He said, you taught me two things. You taught me honor. And you taught me the seed. I just made 2 television programs with him Monday. Hallelujah. If you discover the divine deposits inside you, you can sow every day of your life. And as quick as you can sow, you can reap. Hallelujah. I don't sow and wait for that seed. I grab the next seed. I grab the next seed. I grab the next seed. I got the next seed. Now, next year is my greatest year of my life. It's going to be called the Year of the Seed, 2013. And I intend to sow every conceivable possible thing I have next year back to God. Because he said, I'll give seed to a sower. All I have to do to get seed is tell God, I'm one of the sowers. Oh, okay. Woman came up to me and she said, Brother Mike, I wish I had $1,000. God knows I wish I had, but I don't even have $1,000. I said, there's only one reason. You ain't got $1,000. I said, here you are, a half a century old. You've been on the earth 50 long dinosaur years. And you still don't even have $1,000. What kind of woman are you? To live on the earth 50 years. And don't even have $1,000. I said, there's only one reason you hadn't got $1,000. God doesn't think you're a sower. Because he said, I'll give seed to a sower. Amen. I grabbed her hand. I said, Father, give her $1,000. And I had a letter into a prayer. I said, Lord, from now on, I'm going to be a sower. Please, I am a sower. So now you're qualified. See, God's not authorized to give you money unless you're going to be a sower. He's not even authorized to give you money. He can't by his own character. If I find a sower, I'll give it to him. Next day, somebody walks up to her on the streets of San Jose, California, shoves something in her hand, and took off running, and she opens her hand. It's 10 $100 bills. She calls him on the phone and said, it works! It works! Duh. Somebody asked me, can you have that song, I Love Sitting at Your Feet? Somebody asked me, Dr. Mike, does this seed, the law of the seed, does this work? A Brazil pastor, does this work in Africa? I said, have you been to Africa? He said, yes. I said, you want to know if the seed works in Africa? Yes. I said, did you see any kids in Africa? Did you see any children? He said, I saw lots of children. Then the seed works. I said, did you see any pineapples? Did you see any bananas? Did you see any fruit? Yeah, a lot of fruit. The seed works. Did you see any animals? Oh, we went to a reserve and we saw so many elephants and rhino. And then you said, does the seed work? I said, did you see any trees? Was there any bushes? Was it all pavement? Was it asphalt? Or did you see some flowers? Was there any trees? You see any trees in Africa? Tell somebody next to you, if you stay stupid, I cannot be your friend. Just look at them right in the eye and say, if you stay stupid, I cannot be your friend. Would you stand with me? Hold your Bible in your hand. Hallelujah. Stroke your Bible. Sing it with me. I love sitting at your feet. I love hearing what you say. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I love knowing your desires. I'm so pleasured to obey. I'm so pleasured to obey. Your favor is like sunrise. Your favor is like sunrise. Driving all my nights away. All my nights away. I love sitting at your feet. Every single day. Everybody, wave a hand to God. I love sitting at your feet every single day. There are three things I want you to do as you return back home tonight. Number one, designate a wall to have pictures of your future. I call it your dream wall. Normally, our houses hold pictures of the past. Now, if you get into a lot of mind teaching, which is not bad to understand the power of the mind, they say if you keep an object that brought you pain, if you keep it around, that every time you look at that object, you'll replay that moment of pain, and it keeps you connected to the source of your pain. You should have pictures of the future and keep plaques like my mother did. Every time God answered a prayer, she bought a plaque and put it on the wall to remind her of that answered prayer. David did that. He kept the head of Goliath on the end of his bed. So when he woke up, he looked at it and said, I still have it. You want pictures of your victories. The divine purpose of memory is to review and replay and re-air past victories in your life. If I walk into your home, I should see pictures of your future. Pictures of your future. Because God's conversations only revolve around your future. God is not a yesterday God. He's a tomorrow God. Remember not the former things. I will do a new thing. What's his first self-description of himself?
chapter 1 of Genesis, verse 1. He said, I'm a creator. That's me. He didn't say, I'm a lover. I love everybody. Just love everybody. Jesus said, God says, I'm a creator. When you think of me, think of a creator. I do new stuff. Even my mercy is brand new every morning. Hallelujah. I saw a little sign in a bookstore, and it said this. It's a book, a new book out. Real men hate shopping. And I started laughing, and I told the people with me, I said, wow, had no idea I was half woman. No idea, because I love shopping. I think heaven's going to be what I want. I don't think it's going to be a big white Suffolk with angels floating around. Whoa! Why? Because I wouldn't like that. I go to prepare a place for you. I think heaven's going to be a mall where everything is free. Say, I'm a receiver. Say it again, I am a receiver. Hallelujah. He's a creator. What future have you dreamed about? The birthplace is inside of you. Hallelujah. Think of the top 10 goals of your life. And in 72 hours, have pictures of every one of those goals on the wall at your house. And when you wake up every morning, you look at that wall and you prophesy. And you speak to the future. And you instruct the day on what to bring you. Hallelujah. 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 The day is my servant. I said, the day is my servant. I said, the day is my servant. Stay close to your investment. Make the next season your obsession. Hallelujah. Don't you feel something supernatural happening in your spirit? Hallelujah. 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 Now, when I talk about, just before we pray, when I talk about being a good receiver, I don't mean that you're able to hold out your hands longer than anybody else. When I talk about being a receiver, I don't mean that you find a cup bigger than everybody else's to hold the toys. When I talk about being a good receiver, what I mean is you know the character of the God who is your source. And you recognize what He has already given to you. Something you've been given will create anything you've been promised. The widow of Zarephath said, yes, sir. You're Elijah. I've watched you on TV. And Elijah said, do you have a good meal for me? She said, I'm down to my last sandwich. A half goes to my son. The other half I eat, and we're dying. Elijah didn't look at her and say, well, let's just believe God that some of these churches around here will, they'll bring you some food. They'll bring you some groceries for your child. Let's just believe God will send somebody to your house. He said, something you've got will create something you've not. Something you've got can create anything. What you got? She said, I got a sandwich. He said, bring it to me. And then he paints a picture of her harvest. He didn't say to her, now when I go to your funeral next week,
I'll tell them how you gave up your last meal for me. Praise God. God's going to got you a mansion in heaven. He says the cruse of oil will not fail. The meal barrel will not run dry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, lady in Atlanta, Georgia, came up to sow $1,000. She wanted a scholarship from Harvard for her daughter. On the 27th day, her daughter got 4 years full paid by Harvard University. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I told the lady in Knoxville, Tennessee, she said her husband hadn't given her child support. In 15 years, they've been divorced, not one check. I said, put his name on the check. Focus your seed. Your seed needs an instruction from you. Talk to your seed. God had a son, but he wanted a family. So he spoke to his son and created a family. 2 weeks later, she got her first check from him, her first check for $65,000. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. Something I've got will create anything I want in my future. Hallelujah. I love this phrase, tonight's the poorest I will ever be the rest of my life. Say that out loud. Tonight is the poorest I will ever be the rest of my life. St. Louis, Missouri, Church on the Rock. Pastor David Blunt. And just before I turned the service to Pastor Blunt, known him since he's a teenage boy, God said, tell somebody that if they want a debt-free house, plant a seed like you did, equal to a monthly payment on the house. Write it on the check, debt-free home in 12 months to do what you did. A year later, I go back there, and a young man came back, and he followed me back to the pastor's office. He said, sir, I need just one word. Last time you was here, you said, if we want a debt-free house, sow a seed equal to 1 month's monthly payment. Wrap expectation, he said, today, I'm living in a house worth $1.1 million, and it's debt-free because of the seed that night. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Say, I've decided to receive. And then he pulled out a check for $4,700 that I saw another house on the lake. And so I'm sowing this house for that house to be debt free. I'll never forget, I was in Charles Blake, Bishop Charles Blake's church in out in Los Angeles one Sunday morning. Denzel Washington goes there and his wife there. And God spoke to me and said, I want you to plant another seed equal to your monthly house payment. And I said, God, I already did that, and I'm thankful my house is debt free. And he says, is that the only house you'll ever want to own? Well, no. You want another house? Uh-huh. And God's given me more than one house debt free. Say it out loud. I'm not jealous. I'm happy. I'm not jealous. I'm happy. And everything God does for Mike Murdock, he'll do for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Stretch forth your hand toward me, would you? Stretch forth your hand toward me. Vambroshe libiki sevyambro de devi paroko. Vaseta taboshe viambranda the bocombra tadaboko. Brosse de levia sambra to the bokit viase. Bosheke viambrandi de the bocombriasa. Leka, 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 ropocombra tataha. Boko sheke. Brondi di viki sombra. Branda la boko sombra tadabacataboye. Father, I release a Boaz anointing. I release a Boaz anointing. Everything you do for me, do for them. Every time you give me a miracle, give them a miracle. I sanctify the seeds of this family in this house. Lord, you gave Jesus 12 disciples. You had 12.
12 tribes, and the New Jerusalem has 12 gates. And I sanctify 12 in this room to enter into a new covenant. I ask you for 12 in this room who will present you a $1,000 seed in 12 days from today. And I decree that 2013 will be the year of unprecedented sowing in their life. That they will be so much that they'll confuse their harvest and the seed they're so sowing. Let there be rivers of honor flow toward their life. Rivers of favor flow toward their life. Father, I don't know who the 12 are. I don't know their address. I don't know where the 1,000 is. It may be money they put aside for traveling. Put it aside for retirement. It may be emergency money that they put aside for an emergency. But tonight we end this year with a new seal, a new covenant of the seed. Whether they're the 12 or in this room, or whether they're watching from their home somewhere in the world, I sanctify this seed as holy, as righteous. And I call the 100-fold return. I call the 100-fold return on this $1,000 seed. I command this seed to do the impossible. I command this seed of $1,000 that reaches 1 million homes of the gospel. I sanctify this $1,000 seed as the seed of a lifetime. I ask you for a debt-free home testimony for these 12 people. Two, I ask you for a sevenfold return of anything Satan has stolen from them in the last 12 years of their life. And three, I decree a Boaz step out of the shadows of their life and bless them and be good to them. Father, somebody's going to be given a car in the next 90 days in this room. Somebody's going to be given a car in the next 90 days in this room. I sanctify this 1,000 as the beginning of the happiest year of our lifetime. This is our happy year. This is our happy year. Hallelujah. Oh, family, lift up both hands and just say, God, I'm a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. Abrokosevi. Bishop James, would you come and stand with me here in a covenant? Come stand here on the platform with me in a covenant. I'm going to pray a brief prayer. There's three things I want to release over the 12's life, over 12 people in this room. You may cannot sow it tonight. It may be something you're going to sow in the next 12 days. You may be watching on the internet. There's three things. Number one, I want this to become a debt-free testimony for you, that your house is debt-free. And a house that is so nice, your enemies cannot sleep at night looking at pictures of your house. If your enemies haven't noticed you, we got to get you blessed. I said, we've got to get you blessed. We've got to get you blessed. If your enemies can ignore you, you're a long way from the 100-fold return. The Bible says in Isaac's day, and the Philistines envied him. The second harvest is a sevenfold return of anything God, Satan has stolen from you in the last 12 years. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the righteous. And number three, somebody will decide to bless you. You don't need everybody liking you, just the right person liking you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. About 13 or 14 Sunday nights ago, Bishop, Pastor Alan Carr said, a man and his wife want to meet you. They became a millionaire through your teaching. So he brought them in. Man looked at me and he said, you changed my life.
77 checks had bounced, and I lost all my credibility in my city. Nobody believed in me. Lost my house, lost everything, and I went to a school of wisdom. And you said you broke the back of poverty with a $1,000 seed. He said, today, I'm worth millions. And this is what he said. He said, my last offering to my church was for $250,000. And then he said, I brought you a seed of honor. And it was a seed of $8,500. And I kind of felt let down. I thought he was fixing to go the quarter of a million level, you know. And he says, I brought you a seed of honor of $8,500. And I said, oh, brother, I wish you'd have waited and brought me that quarter of a million for the ministry. I said, we could have used that quarter of a million for the ministry. I took his hand. And as I began to pray for him and his wife, tears began to stream down their face. They just began to weep and cry. And he said, you'll never know what your teaching on expectation has done in my life. It's changed my world. He was my 31st millionaire. I've asked God for 300. Now, I don't think a million's a whole lot of money. It is when you're broke. You know, $100 is a lot when you're broke. But if God begins to bless you, a million is nothing to when God begins to bless you. How many want a vision so big that it'll take $1 million house just to launch your ideas and your plans? Just wave a hand to God. Just wave a hand to God. Father, I set myself in covenant with 12 people in this room who in the next 12 days or tonight will plant a $1,000 seed. I wrap expectation around it. I ask you for 3 miracles. Give them a debt-free home, a 7-fold return on anything stolen. And 3, put somebody capable of blessing them. Like a Boaz looked at Ruth in the field. In Jesus' name. If you're one of the 12, quickly get out of your seat and come stand here quickly. Don't wait for anybody else. Brother Mike, I'm one of the 12. Quickly come and stand here. I love sitting at your feet. Lift your right hand high to God and say, God, I've chosen to be a receiver. Say it again, Lord, I've chosen to be a receiver. Say it again, I've chosen to be a receiver. Quickly come. We'll wait for just a few moments. His sheep know his voice. Never negotiate with the Holy Spirit. Never negotiate with the Holy Spirit. I don't know where the thousand's at, but it's not enough to buy you a car. It's not enough to buy you a house. A thousand isn't even enough to get you on a good vacation. If your seed is not, if what you have is not enough, you make it a seed. Quickly come. Quickly come. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister. God bless you, my sister. Anyone else quickly supposed to come? If you're watching by the internet and you want to sow that seed, you should go to button 8. Button 8. There's a place to sow. There's a place to sow. Quickly come and stand with me here. There's something electrifying about the $1,000 seed. I don't know what it is, but you break something in your life. A person who can sow $1,000 has broken the back of greed. It's impossible to sow a $1,000 seed and say you're greedy. Or Satan can never accuse you of being greedy. Never. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Who are the other 5? Quickly come. Quickly come. Hallelujah. Praise God. Pastor Ron Bowman, I want you to bring those Bibles and bring them, put them in their hand, because God's going to give them a new revelation. God bless you, Roxanne. God bless you. Anyone else, if you're supposed to be up here, quickly come. Quickly come. Quickly come. Mike, in the next 12 days, God knows I can faith in a $1,000 seed. If you can't even call in seed, how could you ever call in a harvest? You have to get good at calling in seed. You have to get good at calling in seed. God said, I will give seed to a sower. Anyone else? Anyone else? Just feel like there's a real anointing on this $1,000 seed tonight. There's a real grace. There's a real grace. Bishop, when you told me through my secretary, said, I want us to plant a seed in Dr. Murdock's vision, his life, and what he's doing. I want to. Who else can help you? You have any, Brother Benjamin, you want to help him? Thank you, my brother. I want everyone to hold these in your hand for just a moment. Because God's going to double your wisdom.
God's going to double your wisdom. Every person standing up here, you're going to make decisions that create increase and not decrease. I feel like you will not make a wrong decision in the month, in the year of 2013. You will not make a wrong decision in the year 2013. Hallelujah. 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 Imagine 12 months and no decision take you backward. How many like to have 1 year of no wrong decisions? Hallelujah. 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 No wrong decisions for 12 months. I want to just say God is electrifying me with things He's given me in the last few weeks. I am so stunned. Today I changed my whole dictation system today. I got up, told my sister today at Deborah, I said, God has given me the most electrifying ideas and insights I've ever had in my lifetime. How many like have 1 year and no decision would take you backwards? Every decision take you far. See, we'll take 3 steps forward, then 2 steps back. Then we take 2 steps forward and then 4 steps back. That's why we don't get anywhere. 12 months, 2013 is my year. It's my year for godly decisions. Hallelujah. 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 Boshe ke vi ambrata sa ha. Landa lo voco sombre, andadra boco satara boco ye. Vese brocombra satabaye. Father, I don't know if he knows or not, but somebody owes him. And I decree that they come out of the shadows of yesterday and decide to bless him with interest to spare. Things he may not even know about, but I see a catch-up program. Father, you're going to set in motion a catch-up program. He is going to catch up on everything Satan has taken from him, known or unknown. Hallelujah. Say it aloud, I'm a receiver. I am a receiver. I am a receiver. There's 4 or 5 across the room that would love to be up here with these. There's only one reason you're not. You have no idea where 1,000 is going to come from. If you're willing to let me work with your faith, I'll enter into a covenant that God will supernaturally give you $1,000 in a surprise way you never thought about. Now, if God doesn't give it to you, you can't sow it. So don't feel condemned. But I want every person in this room, said Mike Murdock, if God will give me a surprise $1,000 seed, I will sow it when he gives it to me. Quickly come. This is not a place of torment. You're not going to take a vow and then God, if God doesn't give it to you, you can't sow it. You can only sow it if God gives it to you. You can only sow it if God gives it to you. But he said, prove me. God wanted to be proven in the area of finances. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jeannie, God could give you a surprise $1,000. Did you know that? Did you know God could give you a surprise $1,000? Edie, God could give you a surprise $1,000. I'm a receiver. Hallelujah. Work, you see, you work with your faith on your seed. You work with your seed. You work with your seed. The furthest thing from my mind was owning a jet that could fly me everywhere. That's the furthest thing from my mind. But on a Wednesday afternoon at 4:30, God gave me an instruction and said, do it by 10 o'clock tonight. In 72 hours, God had so opened the windows of heaven on my life that I was able not only to buy that jet, but I bought a second jet worth 3 times what that one was. And then a third jet. Thank you, Roxanne. You're the only happy one with me here. Say, I'm a receiver. Hallelujah. If God ever gives you a jet, would you give your testimony publicly to people? Tell them. Would you tell everybody? Would you tell everybody? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God says it's His pleasure to give to us the kingdom. I'm a receiver. Just say it aloud. I am a receiver. Praise God. Father, before our bishop receives this seed covenant in this room, and even before someone in their home watching there in our internet family, even before they go to button 8, I sanctify this seed as holy. Some of us don't even have $1,000. All we have in our purse or our wallet is $20 bill or $50. We barely have enough seed to get a harvest going. But tonight we enter into a covenant. And I set myself an agreement on December the 15th, 2012, at the Hyatt Hotel at Dallas-Fort Worth Airport. I set myself an agreement tonight for a 100-fold return based on the eagle promise of Mark chapter 10. I create a change with my faith in their life. Let this be the turnaround night. Let this be the turnaround night. I decree a year, 2013, that no wrong decision will take our finances, but every decision will create increase and not decrease. Every investment we make will be a God investment. I decree a debt-free home. Somebody will write a book out of this time tonight. Somebody will write a book on this testimony. Father, this seed tonight is the birthing of the best financial testimony of our lifetime. There will be a sevenfold return of everything Satan has stolen from us. And somebody that's capable is about to bless us supernaturally. In Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Father, we're all prospects. We're all receivers of the divine covenant. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Can you remember that phrase? Today is the poorest I'll ever be the rest of my life. Say that with me. Today is the poorest I will ever be the rest of my life. Hallelujah. 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 I can create any future I want with my faith. Hallelujah. I made a decision years ago that I would not touch the tithe and offerings of the wisdom side, that my faith would create. And the lady who handles those checks, where's Linnell Strauss? Pastor Linnell, are you there? We have seen it come to pass, haven't we? She'll text me and said, "You will not believe what happened today." Praise God is her statement. Every time God blesses me, you ready for flying zone? Yes, sir. You're not going to go to barnyards for chicken conferences ever again. Eagles. Say it out loud. I'm an eagle. I'm an eagle. Say it again. I am an eagle. Hallelujah. So tomorrow when you're on the phone and somebody's full of doubt and unbelief, just take a little pen and go, barnyard conversation. And say, oh, I've got to go. But before I go, I'm going to pray an eagle prayer over your life. That God will give you the stench of the barnyard so strong that you'll never talk barnyard conversation again. I am an eagle. Oh, hallelujah. I am an eagle. Say it again. I am an eagle. Miss Estella, you are an eagle. You are an eagle. Pastor Davis, you are an eagle. Hallelujah. You've got eagle written all over you. Hallelujah. 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 I love sitting at your feet. Everybody, I love hearing what you say. I love hearing what you say. I love knowing your desires. I love knowing your desires. Before you go back to your seat, turn to two or three people and just look them in the face again and say, I see prosperity dripping all over your future. I see prosperity dripping all over your future. Then you may return back to your seat. Praise God. Thank you, Bishop.